Good morning, this is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I'll focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that is God's word to us in our modern language. And let's start today with Psalm 86. Incline your ear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my life, for I am devoted to you. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all day long. Gladden the soul of your servant, for to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call on you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my cry of supplication. In the day of my trouble I call on you, for you will answer me. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and bow down before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name. I give thanks to you, O Lord my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever. For great is your steadfast love toward me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. O God, the insolent rise up against me. A band of ruffians seeks my life, and they do not set you before them. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give your strength to your servant. Save the child of your serving girl. Show me a sign of your favor, so that those who hate me may see it and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Those are God's words from Psalm 86. Our musical guest today is a selection from a Winter's Solstice 5. That has been a selection from a Winter Solstice 5. We'll hear another selection at the end of the program. Turn with me, if you can, to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 2, verses 1 through 18. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him, and calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people, Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he said to them, to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own countries by another road. Now after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night, and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." When Herod saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, he was infuriated, and he sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had learned from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. "A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing and loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled because they are no more." Those are God's words from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 18. Little Margie was just 4 years old, and her parents were trying to tell her about the true meaning of Christmas. It was tough with all the messages about Santa and whatnot, but they thought that they had gotten the message through to her about how Jesus' birth was the reason for all the celebrations. Margie had a great and wonderful Christmas holiday. She opened her gifts, she tore open the wrapping paper and played in the boxes, and ate lots of Christmas cookies, which were all shaped like little green trees. Indeed, they had a great party. A few days after all the festivities, Margie was talking to her older sister, and her parents happened to overhear. Margie said, "Oh, I sure like Christmas. I hope that Mary and Joseph have another baby." In our passage today, we see that at that first Christmas, it was not all just glitter, tinsel, and fun times. In our passage today, we see that when Jesus Christ was born, there was already opposition to his ministry. Truly, from the moment when that miraculous star appeared in the heavens, the stage was set for the conflict between good and evil. At Christmas, we often think of all the wonderful stories. We see the television stations playing "It's a Wonderful Life" for the 10 billionth time. We see reruns of Miracle on 34th Street and Bing Crosby's White Christmas. We hear Frosty the Snowman and Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer playing on the radio. And who can forget those new Christmas songs like Jingle Bells by the Barking Dogs or that ever odd Walking Around in Women's Underwear? Yes, often we seem to think that Christmas is just a fun time, all about glitter and gold and everything cold. But when we look back to that very first Christmas, we see a different picture. We see the poor, displaced teenagers huddling in a cold animal shelter. We see Mary birthing her baby without the aid of a midwife or an experienced doctor. And Joseph probably did his very best to assist Mary with the delivery, but I doubt that he had much experience delivering a baby. As to the Jewish mindset way back 2,000 years ago, a man was not to get exposed to a woman's private parts or her menstrual flow or even get near a woman in, as they so crassly put it, her time of uncleanness when she's pregnant. So imagine in your mind's eye, there in that darkness is Mary pushing out her firstborn son, and Joseph is trying to help, but not really knowing all that is necessary. And the animals are all watching as the Messiah is born. For Jesus was born in that poverty-stricken, humble surrounding. Yes, the Lord of glory, the creator of all that exists, the all-powerful God incarnate, was born and laid in strips of cloth and cradled by an animal trough. In Philippians 2:5-11, we read, "Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." When Jesus was born, who came to attend to his needs? Well, certainly his mother Mary was there to cuddle, nurse, and protect him. And Joseph, Mary's new husband, was there to assist. Even though Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary, Joseph would play the role of protecting father and guide for Jesus. And as the Bible tells us, after Jesus was born and Mary was healed, Joseph and Mary shared the intimacies that all marriages need, for they had a sexual relationship and other children were born. After Jesus was born, Mary and Joseph had sons and daughters. The sons' names were James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon. But sadly, the names of Jesus' sisters are lost to history. But way back that first Christmas night, there were the shepherds who came to bow low before the newborn king. Those shepherds were one of the lowest class of people, uneducated, underemployed, rather unskilled, and often thought of as lazy deadbeats. But that first Christmas night, the angels had appeared to the shepherds and proclaimed, "Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." Now, December 25th is probably not the exact date of Jesus' birth. December 25th is the time when we remember and celebrate the birth of Christ, but it is more likely when Jesus was born. It was in the springtime, probably about the year 5 BC. Remember, the calendar we use was not invented until centuries after Jesus' birth. Yes, Jesus was probably born in the springtime, for that is when the shepherds are out in their flocks at night, tending to the newborn lambs. And that is like God, isn't it? For while the shepherds were out tending their flocks and protecting the newborn lambs, it was at that time when the Lamb of God was born, the Lamb of God who came to take away the sins of the world. So when the angels announced the birth of the Messiah, the shepherds took off and headed to Bethlehem. They left their flocks with their newborn lambs to go and search out the Lamb of God, the newborn King. Have you ever wondered, well, where were the religious guys? Where were all the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Essenes and the regular Jews of that day? Well, none of them were looking for a Messiah who would come as a lamb. Some were looking for a political Messiah. They wanted someone to come and save them in their political lives. Others were looking for an economic Messiah who would come and give them all food and jobs and provide for their physical needs. Many people were looking for a military Messiah, a man who would ride in on a great white horse and kick the butts of the Romans and drive them out of the Holy Land, and then restore the military might of David's empire. Yes, those people who did have messianic expectations were almost all incorrect in how they thought the Messiah would come. The ox and the donkey who watched the birth of Christ in that dirty stable, those animals knew more about the Messiah than did most of the religious leaders of that day. For a good number of the religious leaders of that ancient time over 2,000 years ago were not even looking for a Messiah, but were just trying to make brownie points with the Romans. And one of those people was King Herod. Yes, we often think of happy and joyous thoughts at Christmas, but there does remain that evil figure of Herod. The Roman Emperor Augustus said, "I would rather be one of his pigs than one of his sons." I would rather be one of his pigs than one of his sons. Yes, that is how Herod was described. I would rather be one of his pigs than one of his sons. Now, in the Bible, there are a bunch of King Herods. There were at least three major King Herods. The King Herod in our passage today is the first of the line of King Herods. He is called Herod the Great, but he is only great in his own mind and great in his evil. The other King Herods are the descendants of this King Herod. This is the King Herod who ruled during the time of the birth of baby Jesus. And this King Herod died in about 4 BC. So Jesus was born sometime before the year 4 BC. Now that sounds kind of odd, doesn't it? But you must remember that our current calendar really is not that accurate, and it was kind of messed up during the Middle Ages. For it has now been literally over 2,000 years since Jesus was born. And King Herod came to power about 40 years prior to our passage today. Herod's father was Antipater. Herod came to power at age 25 after the mysterious death of his father, Antipater. Antipater died of poisoning, and knowing Herod's character and his life of violence, it leaves little doubt in my mind that King Herod probably murdered his father in order to come to power. Herod's three brothers were all murdered during the reign of King Herod. But just murdering his father and his three brothers, that's not the only acts of evil brutality that we remember Herod. He also was known for violence against anyone at all he perceived as a threat to his rule. King Herod was married to at least 10 different women. He had numerous children from these marriages, but King Herod often saw his own sons as threat to his rule. Historians tell us that King Herod had three of his own sons murdered because they were getting old enough to be a potential rival for his crown. King Herod also executed many of his wives and any other family members who crossed paths with his domination. And King Herod even manipulated and controlled the religion of his day. Herod had assassinated or otherwise removed the majority of the Pharisees and Sadducees, the religious leaders of that day, and replaced them with his own evil cronies. Yes, King Herod's way was one of supreme violence. And in our passage today, we see that when Herod could not find the Christ child, he ordered the murder of all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old and younger. This is remembered as the Massacre of the Innocents. Some churches remember this horrific evil by a special prayer that is offered during this Advent season. O Holy God, receive into your arms of mercy all the innocent victims who have been so savagely murdered. Lord, by your great might, frustrate the plans of today's evil tyrants and establish your rule of love, justice, mercy, and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was born to free us from evil. Amen. Now, you might very well be asking yourself, what in the world does that evil King Herod have to do with me? Well, we still live in a world that has some little King Herods. I was recently driving down the interstate and was tailgated by a pickup truck for a good bit of distance. His lights were blaring into my car, and then that person behind me swerved around me, raced past me on the right, and then cut in front of me and tailgated the next car. and then swerved around that car as well, repeating that. A few minutes later, I exited the interstate, and there at the stop sign ahead of me was that pickup truck. The man jumped out of his truck and ran up to my car, yelling obscenities and cursing a blue streak. It was horrible. He screamed things about getting out of his way as he drove, and he called me so many names, I probably could have started a dictionary of foul language. I rolled down my window and I told the man, "You have a real problem with anger, don't you?" And then I asked him, "Well, should I just call the police and report your driving?" And the man left in a huff. So yes, today we still meet these little petty dictators throwing their weight around, but what do? Well, we must remember why Jesus came into the world. Jesus was born at just the right time to save humanity from our sinful ways. As we read in Ephesians 2, 1 through 5, "You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. For by grace you have been saved." Yes, Jesus came to save us from sin, for the end result of sin is death, and I am a sinner, and so are every one of us. A mean old man underwent surgery to replace a bad heart valve. During the surgery, the warehouse across the street from the hospital caught on fire. It was a huge inferno. Flames were shooting up hundreds of feet in the air. Thick black smoke was belching out. The fire was burning brightly. And across the street, the man in the hospital was rolled into the recovery room. As he began to awaken from the anesthetic, he saw the flames dancing through the window. And he asked the nurse, "Did the surgery fail? Is that why hell is out there waiting for me?" Yes, we all would be lost if it were not for that little baby born in Bethlehem's stable. For Jesus came to save us from our own sins. When we know that we are guilty as sinners, we can call out to Jesus and he will grant us his grace. That doesn't make us better than anyone else, just forgiven. And that is what Christmas is all about, knowing Jesus as our Master and Messiah. For Jesus Christ is the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. But just having Jesus as our Lord and Savior is not enough in our lives. We must also love others because we have been loved by God. For as Christians, we must be so grateful for God's grace that we serve others out of gratitude. A few weeks before Christmas, 2 9-year-old girls, Katie and Jennifer, were walking along sliding on the ice in the street. They were discussing Christmas and what they expected. And they saw an old man shoveling the snow off his yard and trying to pull the weeds out between the patches of snow and ice. They walked over and asked Henry what he was doing. Henry responded, "Well, I want to give my yard in good shape as a gift for my wife. She always hated the weeds, and she really liked a nice-looking yard, and I was not able to do it this fall when she was in the hospital after she got hit by that drunk driver. I want to give her a Christmas present because I can just not stop thinking about her since she died last month." Katie and Jennifer saw that Henry was crying. He was also wearing a frayed and worn jacket, which did not zip together anymore. His really shoddy gloves had holes, and his fingers were poking through the holes and were turning cold and blue. The girls were touched as he spoke. They both bent down and started to pull out the weeds and clean up the yard. It took the three of them the rest of that afternoon to finish the yard work. When they were finished, Henry gave the girls each a dollar and said, "Oh, I wish it were more. You both helped me so very much." As the girls walked away, they looked back and saw Henry sitting in his rocker alone in front of his big empty picture window. They remembered that they had passed Henry's house many times this year but had not seen a wreath or a Christmas tree, no lights or any other signs of joy or celebration. As they walked, they just could not stop thinking of Henry, and the picture of his cold blue fingers stayed in their minds. The next day, Katie and Jennifer placed the dollars that Henry had given them into a glass jar and labeled it Henry's Christmas Gift. They took this to their youth group and explained the situation to their youth pastor. Then all the kids in the youth group began doing odd jobs and earning money for Henry's Christmas gift. 2 days before Christmas, they had enough money to get Henry's gift. They bought him a new coat, new gloves, a small Christmas tree for his window, and a set of gardening tools and flower seeds for him to use in the spring. As the youth group came over to Henry's house and presented him with the gifts, he held them in trembling hands and started to cry. As he looked at the flower seeds, he said, "These were my wife's favorites. Thank you so very much." So yes, in this world, there are those people who have chosen to be little King Herods, and we have to deal with them. But there is also Jesus Christ, our loving Lord and Savior, and he shows us a better way to live, the way of love. I'm John Thornton. Thanks for listening to Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship, be encouraged, and celebrate the gift of love that we've got from God. For this area offers many fine Bible-believing and teaching churches of various denominations. I invite you personally to come out for our Christmas evening service or our Christmas Day service at Community Reformed Church, 3800 East 15th. Or you can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota 57101. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. And always remember, the Bible says that love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends. So love Jesus Christ our Lord with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind, and love your neighbors as yourselves. And as Christians, we are even commanded to love our enemies. We'll finish today with an instrumental selection from a Winter Solstice 5.